We're going to switch over now to recombination losses in perovskite solar cells. Juan Anta will present on that in another brief summary talk. And I hope, as usual, that technology works. But otherwise, here we go.
Okay. Thank you very much. My name is Juan Antonio Anta. I'm coming from University Pablo Lavide in Seville, Spain, and that's the title of my talk. I'm going to talk about recombination in perovskite solar cells. I'd like to start by reusing a slide that Professor Parr showed the other day in this conference. Sorry about the quality, it was taken with my camera, with the mobile phone camera, but basically the learning of this plot is whereas in a perovskite solar cell, in terms of self-circuit photocurrent, we are very close to the theoretical limits. In terms of voltage, there is still much room for improvement. And that means to improve in current management, and current management in a solar cell is making transport faster and making recombination slower. So we are concerned about recombination in solar cells, in particular in perovskite solar cells, and our approach is to use a small perturbation optoelectronic techniques. Of which the most popular one is impedance spectroscopy. Basically, in an impedance measurement, you locate your cells at a certain point in the IV curve and you set up a certain bias, a certain voltage bias, and then you apply a small electrical perturbation in terms of voltage and then you register the response in terms of current. The impedance is the ratio between the voltage with respect to the current. And if your experiment you do it using a frequency modulated excitation, you can obtain an impedance which is frequency dependent. There are also another small perturbation techniques in which the perturbation is optical, that's an intensity modulated photocurrent spectroscopy, and intensity modulated photovoltaic spectroscopy. The difference is in one case the experiment is galvanostatic and in the other case the experiment is potentiostatic. So when you do an impedance measurement of a perovskite solar cell, the typical response is that you obtain two signals characterized by two peaks in the frequency plot. So if you plot the imaginary part of the impedance versus frequency, you observe one plot at low frequencies and one peak at low frequencies, another peak at high frequencies. The peak at high frequencies is the one that we associate to recombination, because when we illuminate, this peak shifts to higher frequencies, you are generating more carriers, and therefore those carriers recombine faster. Another indication that this is a way of measuring, at least qualitatively, recombination is when you are using a not very good Hall conductor, like for instance copper titanate in this case, that produces a smaller photovoltage. Also, this peak shifts to higher frequencies, meaning that you are somehow accelerating recombination. So there are some questions we are worried in our group, also by reading the papers in the literature and so on, is what is the location of the main recombination path in perovskites? Is taking place in the bulk or is taking place at the contacts? What is really determining the open circuit potential? And what is the nature of recombination at operating conditions in a solar cell, in a perovskite solar cell? So we are doing impedance spectroscopy measurements in a particular way, is that we do then an open circuit, the interpretation is simpler, but we create the bias just by using illumination with different wavelengths, taking advantage of the fact that with blue light, perovskites absorb much strongly at the blue light, and therefore the optical penetration length that you are obtaining when you are illuminating with blue light is much shorter than with red light. So therefore, if you are using a blue light to obtain your impedance spectra, you are probing processes that are taking place preferentially near the front contact of your solar cell. So we have done experiments for many different configurations. Basically, we observe that for fresh cells and well-performing perovskite solar cells, the impedance spectra that you obtain using red and blue light is basically the same. One thing that you can do with impedance spectroscopy is to feed your results to a certain equivalent circuit. The simple choice is just to use two RC elements in series that produces two signals, two time constants in your spectrum. And by fitting to this equivalent circuit, you can obtain a low frequency and a high frequency recombination, and also a low frequency and a high frequency capacitance as well, obviously. I'm going to focus here in the high frequency recombination resistance, which is the one, as I said before, is the one that we associate to recombination, the recombination rate in the solar cell. You always observe when you do the feed at different voltages is that they fit very well to this expression here, that is an exponential dependence with respect to the voltage. And from there, you can extract a parameter that I will connect in a moment with the delity factor of your solar cell. Actually, we proposed this very simple model to explain recombination in a perovskite solar cell. From all the routes that can remove carriers from your device, is bimolecular recombination in the bulk, trough-limited recombination in the bulk, and also surface anionic mediated processes, which we just chose the middle one, the trough-limited recombination, by introducing the relationship that exists between the photoelectric carriers, the band gap, and the voltage. You can obtain a theoretical expression for the recombination resistance, and by imposing the condition of open circuit, that means generation exactly compensates recombination, you can obtain a relationship between the voltage, the light intensity, and the temperature. And actually, this couple of all these formulas explain very well all the data you can obtain in the characterization of your solar cell. Actually, all the recombination resistance versus voltage fit to this expression. So in the semi-logarithmic plot, you obtain straight lines. When you plot the potential, the open circuit potential versus temperature, you obtain a straight line. And if you extrapolate at zero temperature, you reproduce the band gap. And finally, if you plot the potential versus the logarithm of the light intensity, you obtain also a straight line. And the good news is that from all the data, you can fit with exactly the same parameter, which is a gamma exponent of 1 that would correspond to an electric factor approximately of 2, which means that the recombination is in the bulk and also is taking place via trough limited, a sort of Shockley-Reed-Hall recombination mechanism. We also have studied alternative electron-selective contacts. In this paper here, we were comparing the typical mesoporous TiO2 anatase electrodes for perovskite solar cells, but we compare them with nanocolumnar structures, also of TiO2, also crystalline, also anatase, and also with amorphous TiO2, which is characterized for being much less conductive than normal anatase. Interestingly, when you are using the amorphous TiO2, the photocurrent is smaller, but the open circuit voltage is exactly the same. For all these three cases, but this is more or less in accordance to our hypothesis that the open circuit voltage is determined only by the bulk of the perovskite itself. But if you look at the impedance of these amorphous devices, we observe that in this case we start to observe differences between the blue and the red light impedance data, meaning that there are certain surface-mediated processes going on in the device that show up when you compare the blue and the red data. We have also used impedance to analyze how aging under moisture and the ambient moisture affects the device. When we degrade different devices in the presence of humid air, and we obtain the impedance spectra for the red cell, the recombination resistance I showed you before is exactly the same with the red and the blue. When the cell is aged or is degraded, then the recombination resistance becomes smaller, the voltage decreases, we are accelerating the recombination, but interestingly also there start to see differences between the blue and the red light impedance data. Well, another thing that we have seen these degraded devices by using IMPS, this optoelectronic technique I mentioned before, that allows you to extract transport parameters. We observe that for the edge device, this peak that can be associated with transport gets shifted to lower frequencies, meaning that transport gets delayed somehow for the degraded device. And I would like to finish just with this paper we published recently, that this is what we call homeopathic perovskite solar cell, which are perovskite solar cells which are made at ambient conditions at different humidities. And the interesting thing about these devices is that when we prepare the perovskite solar cell at very high humidity, for instance at 50%, this cell resists the aging much better than a cell which has been made in the glove box or at lower humidity conditions, meaning that a small amount of water inside the crystalline structure favors or prevents somehow degradation and the moisture air. So just to finish with some conclusions, some answers to the question I posed before, concerning the location of recombination, at least for good fresh cells at open circuit, the main recombination path takes place in the bulk. What is really determining open circuit potentials is the band gap of the perovskite with the corresponding radiative and non-radiative loss. And as regards the nature of recombination, at least for good fresh cells at open circuit, is strat limited short regularly hold recombination with an LED factor approximately 2. And just to finish with thanking to my research group in Sevilla and also some collaborators and some funding agencies, and thanks to you for your attention.